the Vegas Golden Knights.
The team was Vegas-born and proved to be Vegas-strong after a run to the Stanley Cup Final in year one. On this special edition of the Rebel Report, we take a look back at one of the greatest sports stories ever told, the Golden Knights, from its beginning as a team with no name, no GM, and no head coach, to carrying a city on its back through tragedy. We look back at it all with a few surprises and a lot of fun.
Can I sing? I don't sing at all. No.
We also look towards the future. Team President Kerry Buchholz visits us in studio as our special guest to describe what it was like to be a part of history. So join us as we relive a time so many will never forget for so many reasons. The Rebel Report starts right now.
The incredible journey continues for the Vegas Golden Knights.
What an amazing story, the city of Vegas that has just, quite frankly, almost done the impossible.
Welcome to a special edition of the Rebel Report, or should I say the Golden Knights Report. I'm your host, David Stepanian.
And I'm Lupita Negrete.
This show is all about the Vegas Golden Knights and its first ever season. We tell the incredible story from the beginning with a look on the future.
The Knights have made an impression on the Las Vegas community that will last for decades, and we were along for the ride. During the summer, we normally don't film shows, but we felt that the Golden Knights making it to the Stanley Cup Final and then making history along the way was too important not to do a show about.
You're absolutely right, Lupita. So we've been busy making sure that we get everything covered, from covering the games during the final to checking out just how far the VGK pride had spread around the valley.
But first, let's go back in time to the day when hockey finally arrived to the valley.
Board of Governors approved the plan of expansion that will bring a National Hockey League franchise to Las Vegas, beginning with the 2017-18 season. The actual vote was unanimous.
Our great sports town now has a major league franchise. We want everyone to be a fan. We're dedicated to it.
George McPhee's our guy. He's a former hockey player. He's a lawyer. He was the general manager of the Capitals for 17 years. A very well-managed and successful organization. And I'm proud to introduce him today as our new general manager of our hockey club in Las Vegas. George.
Our mission here is clear. We're going to build an organization and a team that people in Nevada and Las Vegas will be very, very proud of. And we're going to do it quickly, and we're aiming at the Stanley Cup. And it's that simple.
Big smiles, here we go. One, two, three.
One of the most important things is recruiting. So when we want to recruit hockey players from other teams and they come to town, they see T-Mobile Arena and they see our practice facility, they're going to say, wow, these guys are serious. These guys are doing everything first class. There's no question about it. So that's important. And then it's our way to do community outreach. And that's as important as any of the rest. So let's develop the youth hockey program, develop a place for adult leagues to play and hang out, for moms and dads to come watch their kids play in the restaurant. So all that comes together. It's a very important aspect of what we're up to.
I have never seen a turnout like this to name a franchise We are at home in Las Vegas.
Hey, tonight, after 5 months of waiting and work and fooling around with Adidas and trying to get them to come the direction and so on, we actually have created. I'm very proud of our name and I'm very proud of our logo.
3, 2, 1.
And there you go, the Vegas Golden Knights. The Vegas Golden Knights. Oh my! The Vegas Golden Knights, everybody.
It's pretty astonishing to see how far the franchise went from nothing to building a brand new one, and one of the best teams in the NHL.
Without a doubt. And we'll be speaking with team president Kerry Buchholz in just a few minutes to describe being a part of it. But first, we got a lot of hockey to talk about.
Yes, we do. And the Knights had many games in their inaugural season, 82 by my count. But none more important to the city than the home opener on October 10th.
Our reporter Summer Crawley attended the first Major League regular season game in Las Vegas history, and it was a spectacle.
A city that stands with Vegas strong sold out the T-Mobile Arena to witness history as the Golden Knights became the first team in inaugural season to win 3 straight games. A city that is hurting, the Golden Knights helped them heal. Before gaining access inside the arena, fans gathered together to meet and greet players and coaches at the gold carpet. The Knights gave the city an experience that they would never forget.
You know, as proud as we are to be in Las Vegas, when there are times of tragedy, a sports team, particularly one that's been birthed here, can bring a community together, can be part of the healing process, and can be a positive distraction. So we're witnessing a team become an essential part of the community under tragic circumstances.
As hockey goers entered Knights territory to take their seats, the fans were ready to stand as one to honor the Route 91 Festival first responders and victims on October 1st tragedy. Las Vegas local and defenseman Derek England gave a chilling Las Vegas strong speech that was unforgettable.
I met my wife here, my kids were born here, and I know how special this city is. To all the brave first responders who have worked tirelessly and courageously throughout this whole tragedy, we thank you.
As the sold-out crowd waved their Vegas strong towels high in the air, the city was ready for the puck to finally drop center ice. The Knights came out hot and strong. Within the first 10 minutes of the first period, 4 goals were scored, where the second one came from the hero of the night, England.
Looking up top, they score!
The team went on to defeat the Arizona Coyotes 5-2. In NHL history, Vegas is the first expansion team to start their inaugural season 3-0.
I think every guy in this room did a good job of channeling that emotion from the ceremony and using it to an advantage. You know, every guy in here wanted to get this win, and the win for the city and the people. And you know, everyone came out flying and working for one another, and we got that win. So.
Yeah, it went unbelievable. Like, I mean, the script went. It was perfect. Everybody did their job. Everybody came today. Everybody, you know, it was part of the ceremony. I mean, with the teams at center ice and the way everything went down tonight, it was outstanding. They did, our public relations staff, our management staff did a great job planning everything. And then, obviously, the hockey game went the way we wanted it to go, and a lot of guys played well. I think in the third period, the emotions took over, and I think the guys were exhausted mentally and they were tired, and then we just stopped skating, and you know, Phoenix took us, who was pretty good, but you know, we had a big enough lead that we held on, and we found a way to win that game.
It was the first home game of a 7-game homestand where we caught up with the players in the locker room, and all of them seemed eager to have the Vegas crowd behind them for the next couple of weeks. For the Rebel Report, I'm Summer Crawley.
A special night to remember for the city of Las Vegas, but also for the hockey community. That night, the Knights not only united the community, they also helped begin the healing process after the terrible tragedy.
On October 1st, 2017, heartache struck our community when a gunman shot and killed 58 concert attendees, along with injuring more than 500 people.
Michaela Jackson spoke with those closely affected who talk about what the Golden Knights have done for our city.
The Vegas Golden Knights have done so much for our city, including helping us heal from the 1 October tragedy.
When a flag flies high in T-Mobile Arena, it's not just any flag. The flag features 58 stars to represent those who lost their lives on 1 October.
Know that we'll do everything we can to help you and our city heal. We are Vegas strong.
The most important contribution our Golden Misfits did is just be there for us. Show us the impossible.
After their first regular season game in franchise history, the Vegas Golden Knights are headed to the Stanley Cup Final.
Prove to us, no matter what happens, to always be Vegas strong. Cameron Utter is a big fan of the Golden Knights, and he went to save his sister from that night on October 1st.
It all started October 1st, I think, along with a lot of other people. That night, my sister was there. In fact, me and her, my mom next to me, went to go grab her from the event, from the Arco on Harmon and Colval. And just seeing all that, and then afterwards, the team came together, did a lot of community help, everything else. I was just like, this is my team, this is Vegas. I'm born and raised here, so.
Our very own UNLV assistant hockey coach, Nick Raboni, reflects on how this franchise has helped our city heal.
I think that they helped heal our city in a lot of different ways. I would definitely say at the beginning of the year, it was one of those things where they provided 3 to 4 hours of relief. And I think the city really needed something to rally around after October 1, and they provided us with not only a spectacular team and performance on the ice, but they got out in the community and did a lot of great things for people that were really struggling at the time.
The number 58 will forever be retired, not because of a player, but because of the 58 stars shining above.
There's no question this season will never be forgotten because the Golden Knights helped our community when we needed it the most.
Now, from helping our community heal to entertaining it, the Golden Knights gave us a show throughout the season, ending it by becoming the first modern expansion team for any of the four major sports and the first NHL team since the 1927 New York Rangers to win the division in an inaugural season. They then went off to play the Washington Capitals for the Stanley Cup, and I was there to catch all the action, starting with Game 1 on May 28th.
Stanley Cup, Game 1, Las Vegas. Three phrases we never thought we would hear together, but yet here we are after the Golden Knights take Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final.
A fast-paced game full of lead changes and not really knowing who would take the win until the very end. That is exactly what viewers got when watching Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final. The Vegas Golden Knights got off to a good start when Colin Miller scores the first goal of the night. That was short-lived, though, as the Capitals added a goal of their own to tie the game. This sort of thing kept happening throughout the game, both teams going back and forth, and as soon as you thought one team had the lead, the other countered with a goal to tie the score.
John Carlson! And it's tied at 3!
In the end, it was Vegas who took the win 6-4, and a game that left everyone a little winded.
Yeah, maybe a little too exciting, you know, for the goalies, but sometimes it goes that way, right? We don't see it too often, but it will happen, and for me it was just about trying to stop the next one, keep us close in the game, right? And our guys, like I said, have done a great job battling back into it, and we're behind, and got a huge lead at the end.
There's a feeling out process. I don't know if we played their game. There was parts of the game I didn't like, the way we managed pucks and stuff. But I thought, you know, we had good response. most times. We obviously they got the first goal and the crowd was into it and all that, and I didn't like the first part of the second period, but after that I thought we responded a little bit better, and then obviously the lead changed a couple times.
Well, as long as you win at the end of the night, but I'm sure Barry's not too happy with that game, and I'm not overly happy with that game, but the bottom line was we won the game, so we're going to be a lot happier than they are. And it was a bit of a sloppy game and two teams feeling each other out, and I'm sure the next game is going to be a better game.
One of the biggest topics of discussion was the controversial hit on Jonathan Marchessault by Tom Wilson during the third period.
No, we were upset about it. It was a big hit, and you know, Wilson's a great hockey player. He's a competitive guy, and he's an old school player. And you know, for me, it's a late hit, and you know, we're going to stand up for our players. I mean, Marchessault's one of our stars, and we don't like to see that happen. But we reacted real well to it. We won the hockey game. We came back and got two goals after that, and it was a good reaction from our team.
Regardless of the scuffle this hit cost, the Knights still came out victorious, which many say was possible thanks to their fourth line.
Well, it's again, the fourth line went out there, so-called fourth line went out there and battled hard and got pucks down below the goal line, and that's how you score goals in this. And you know, in a tight series when teams are, you know, blocking shots, big rebound goes hard to the net. Nosek makes some good plays to the net, and Belmare competed hard. So they're warriors for us, and they got rewarded tonight.
Well, we have to be. You can't rely on one line or two lines to carry you through a Stanley Cup final. You gotta have depth, and you gotta have scoring from everywhere.
Yeah, they've been great for us, you know, all playoff long, and doesn't matter which guy is in the lineup, who's playing there. I thought again tonight they were huge, and I guess they played well defensively, right? Didn't give in too much, and you know, we're able to contribute offensively too.
History dictates that 78% of the time, the team that wins game one of the final ends up taking the cup. For the Rebel Report, I'm Lupita Negrete.
After winning game one, the odds were in the Knights' favor, and they went into game two hoping to continue that momentum. However, game two on May 30th did not end as brightly as game one, with one defining save that will live on forever in Washington, D.C.
Game two of the Stanley Cup Final, a bit of a shift from game one and not how the Golden Knights wanted it to end, because this time it was the Capitals who had the hockey gods on their side.
To me, it was the hockey gods. They evened it up from last game. I mean, you know, we had a could have tied it up. We didn't. I thought Braden was real good, but I just think we were played the right way. The hockey gods always sort of even it out.
It seemed like game two of the Stanley Cup final could go in the same direction as game one when the Vegas Golden Knights scored the first goal of the night. But that was short-lived as the Washington Capitals scored a goal of their own to tie the game 1-1. The Capitals then went on to score two more consecutive goals, and just when it seemed like Washington had this game in the bag, Shea Theodore scores for Vegas and puts them only one goal down from the Capitals. The third period was when things got intense for both teams. The Knights trying to get a goal in to tie the score, but none of their shots would go in. At one point, they even had five men on the ice, while Washington had three, but they still were unable to score a goal. With 2 minutes left of the game, Alex Tuck took a shot that seemed like it would go in, but Capitals goalie Braden Holtby did what some say was a miraculous save.
In Washington, they'll be calling this the save!
This save helped give Washington a 3-2 win.
You know, it was kind of one of those things is we've been trying to get it up on the glass in our rims because usually goalies stay in their net. But, you know, Marc-Andre's been coming out a lot to get those because they've been so true. And when bounces weird at that time of the game, Eakes makes a great play to pass it over. And I was just trying to get something there, trying to seal where I thought someone would shoot that. And luckily, it hit me.
Yeah, you don't get a whole lot of chances to have 5-on-3s, especially in the Stanley Cup Final. I think if you're not going to score, which, hey, you're not going out there expecting it, but at the same time, you got to at least generate some momentum. And the guys did their best, and hopefully if we get another chance, we'll do a little bit better job.
5-on-3, you got to count on the goal there, but again, they didn't make the right play. They didn't get it through, and you got to give Washington the credit. They did a good job, but definitely got to be better, and we got to get a chance, you know, some quality chance in that 5-on-3.
It's that time of year where you really have to bear down and, you know, for the first game, you know, at their building, we're going to have to come out strong and we're going to really have to, you know, bear down and get back to our basics.
Same as all year. We just keep fighting.
1-1, like you said, things could be worse. And now we go in their building and play our best hockey. We've been good on the road, so no worries.
Now the series goes over to Washington, D.C. Well, we're not going over there. We're actually just happy that we somehow ended up in here. But we're going over to the next best place to watch a game, which is one of the watch parties around town.
All around Las Vegas, there was clearly no shortage of parties to watch the Knights on the road. Throughout the playoffs, Steiner's Pub at the edge of Summerlin was filled with Golden Knights fans showing off their gear during Game 3. Fans cheering for their Golden Misfits once they scored a goal, all giving each other high fives, but then the Capitals extended their lead and won the game 3-1. The owner of Steiner's wanted to let the fans know it's not over.
Right now, it's a little disheartening, but as I told everybody that was in this room, Game 3 doesn't mean anything. When we come back, even if we lose Game 4, it's never over. You know what? We will come back, hopefully, and win Game 4, make it 2-2, get back to Vegas. Hey, it'll be a three-game series.
The Golden Knights were down in the series for the second time since Winnipeg won Game 1 in the Western Conference Finals. Hoping to even the series, the Knights went into Game 4 on June 4th with only one thing in mind, win. The home ice advantage for the Capitals quickly turned out to be of use to them when TJ Oshie scores the first goal of the game, followed by a goal from Tom Wilson and then another from Devontae Smith-Pelly. This sent the Knights into the second period with zero goals scored. Vegas did eventually manage to get in two goals during the third period, one from James Neal and another from Riley Smith, but that didn't stop the Capitals from winning the game 6-2.
You know, we were pushing at the start when the game was tight. We were not fortunate enough to put the puck in the net. They scored a goal, but still, even if they scored, we had still a lot of chances, and unfortunately we didn't. It's just sometimes how hockey is. But like I said, I think with the game what we play, we're pretty happy. We just have to correct a few things, and it's going to be tough.
This defeat left the Knights only one loss away from elimination.
With the stakes so high in the series now, the Knights returned to Vegas for Game 5 on June 7th, hoping that the home ice advantage would help them win.
Even though it ended in defeat, moments after the game, the team had plenty of perspective on its magical season.
The Golden Knights were not ready to say goodbye to the Stanley Cup Final, and this was made clear when they didn't allow the Capitals to score any goals during the first period of the game. However, Washington was also fighting hard and not allowing the Knights any goals of their own, making the game go into the second period with a score of 0-0. It was during the second period when things sped up. Washington scoring a goal, soon followed by one from Vegas. Then another goal from Washington and another from Vegas. With only 28 seconds left of the second period, it was Riley Smith who gave Vegas a 3-2 advantage going into the third period. With 10 minutes left of the game, the Capitals score another goal to tie the game. Then, minutes later, they score yet another one to secure the game 4-3, giving the Capitals their first Stanley Cup win in franchise history.
Alex Ovechkin, it's your honor. Come on up.
I've been in this organization all 13 years or 14, whatever. It was enjoyable. It was a tough time, but, you know, we fight through it and we get results. And this is right now going home to our families, our fans.
Regardless of the loss, the Golden Knights say there are still plenty of other things that they can be proud of.
Just the group in here, coming together as quick as they could, getting into the community after a horrible tragedy and going on a run. And we came up a little short, but I'm sure after the next few days we can look back and take a lot of positives out of the season.
Probably just the fact that we came together unlike any other team and nobody believed in us. I don't think there's a single person who can say that they did, except for the people who are here. And
awesome. It's like I said, it's a fun group of guys. It's a, you know, it's just tough to let it go. You know, it's a great journey. Great journey with the semi-sad ending.
And even though the Knights didn't win the Stanley Cup, they sure won the city over. And I'm sure that we are still going to be seeing that Vegas Golden Knights fever around town. For the Rebel Report, I'm Lupita Negrete. Once the game ended, the Knights made sure to raise their sticks up in salute to the fans that had been with them throughout the entire season.
Now let's send it over to Michaela Jackson with a very special guest.
Straight from Vegas Golden Knights headquarters, we have team president, Carrie Buchholz. Thanks for joining us today.
We're happy to be here.
First off, we have some breaking news. It just came in today, for the day we're recording this. Marc-Andre Fleury has a 3-year extended contract. He's awesome. I love. Thanks, guys. Straight from Vegas Golden Knights headquarters, we have team president, Carrie Buchholz. Thanks for joining us today.
We're happy to be here.
First off, we have some breaking news. It just came in today, for the day we're recording this. Marc-Andre Fleury has a 3-year extended contract. He's awesome. He's my favorite. And he is like the face of the franchise. How do you feel about his extension?
Well, we're excited, and probably the part that's the best part is this was something that he wanted. It wasn't, obviously, he's a great player. He's going to be in the Hall of Fame someday. He had his 400th win this past season, but this was something that was important to him. He's really enjoyed his time. He's been here a little over a year now. He loves the atmosphere. He loves the lifestyle of Las Vegas. His family's enjoyed it, which I think is really important. And this was something that was important to him. And so we were able to get together, and we're excited today that we're announcing that he'll have a three-year extension. So it really amounts. We've got 1 year left under his current agreement. And so he'll be with us for at least the next 4 years. It'll take him through, he'll be like 38. He's 33 right now. He'll be turning 34 during the season. And so could not be more excited. Great person on the ice, but even better person off the ice. And what he does for this community to support our organization. Every day during practice, after practice, he's the first guy over signing autographs for kids. And what you see with that smile really is who he is as a person. And it's awesome to have him as part of our core as we move forward.
First season's over. How did it feel to be a part of the history?
It was outstanding. We're proud. Obviously we didn't get as far as we wanted. We were three games shy of our ultimate goal to win the Stanley Cup. But as we look back in terms of where we thought we would be at this point in our history, obviously we exceeded those expectations on the ice. But I'm more proud of what happened off the ice. And I really believe the way this fan base and this team connected was special. I've been fortunate to be around a lot of situations around the country, and I've never seen a marketplace connect with a team the way I saw it here in Las Vegas. And I think there's a couple of things. One, we certainly helped heal a city during a difficult time, but I also think we helped redefine a city in a different way, and I'm proud of that. And could not be more excited to be a part of this organization, but more important part of the Las Vegas community.
And then at the beginning of the season, we were just the cute story. This was our first season ever. Then in the middle, we were becoming like rock stars because we're the Pacific Division champions. And then it became, in Stanley Cup, the toughest tickets to get. What were your thoughts about that?
Well, it was, the Stanley Cup's a big deal regardless of what market it's in. So we knew there would be a lot of excitement and energy around it. But certainly there was a unique backstory. We were an expansion team, and this is the first time in the history of pro sports that an expansion team that truly came together from other organizations in its first year to be competing, first of all, winning the Pacific Division, which was fantastic, but ultimately winning the Western Conference Championship and then playing for the ultimate prize of the Stanley Cup. That really made just for a special situation. But it also became more of a national and even international story, which added to the mix as part of it. Obviously, the Washington Washington Capitals are a long-standing franchise. They've got a terrific fan base. They hadn't won a championship ever in their 43-year history. And so you put those two components together. And one of the things that I really enjoyed was I got a lot of emails from around the country from fans in Chicago and Detroit and Toronto and all of those other great cities around North America that once their team was no longer alive in the chase, we became their second favorite team and they were going to root for us. And so unsolicited emails from literally all over the North America, and I really enjoyed reading those and getting back to them saying, hey, you know, there's always room for, you know, we'll be your second favorite team. And it was a lot of fun to see happen, but ultimately it translated to just an incredible experience and one we can't wait. You know, October 4th is just around the corner, so we're ready to go.
Was there any Pittsburgh fans since Fleury used to be there?
There was a lot of Pittsburgh fans. Matter of fact, the national TV ratings, so if you look at the ratings for all of the Stanley Cup games, but even just throughout the playoffs, the top markets in the Stanley Cup Finals were, of course, Las Vegas, of course, the D.C. area, which you would expect. The third market was Pittsburgh, and that has a lot to do with Marc-Andre Fleury.
Yes, it does. And then the summer before season one even started, how was the process like starting from scratch?
Well, I think I'll kind of separate the business side from the hockey side of our organization. George McPhee, who's our general manager, he had a real unique opportunity because if you go a year out from the expansion draft, we had our full hockey organization together. So George, all of our scouts, both at the amateur level and the professional level. So while all the other 30 teams were in season during the season ago, our team was spending all of its time focused on the expansion draft in our first season. So we had a little bit of a unique advantage as it relates to the scouting work that was done. And so they just did an unbelievable job. They went through six different mock drafts prior to the expansion draft in June of 2017. And the one quote that George said, which I really think made the most sense, is there wasn't anything that happened during that process for the expansion draft in terms of the players that were made available, and then ultimately the players that we selected, and then the changes that we made from that part of our season to when we got to the, or not the season, but the summer, to the start of the season, there weren't any surprises. And I think the reason why there weren't any surprises and why he made that comment is the preparation that they put into it. And so every player that was available, those were the guys that we expected. And it allowed us to go through a process as it related to those teams. There were certain guys that teams didn't want to lose. And we basically said, look, if you don't want to lose those players, we're open for business. Let's talk. Let's figure out a reasonable solution here. And I think George surprised a lot of people. He didn't always go for the best player available. He was truly looking for character. He was looking for fit. And he was looking for other things that kind of fit into that in terms of could we get other draft picks. And so the chess game that he played with the other general managers around the National Hockey League, I thought it was fantastic. And the results were 109 points, Pacific Division Championship, and one of the best teams in the National Hockey League, and really the best expansion team of all time. And he deserves all the credit. He did a fantastic job.
And then after 1 October, how did you feel like the team played a role in helping heal our city?
Well, I don't think it's something that you plan for in terms of if there's a tragedy, let's do this. You know, once it happened, you just kind of get together and it just happens. And and so we just knew we had to do something. And, you know, that first day after, you know, I think there was a lot of just a lot of quiet time in the office. But I think that next day you could really start to feel how we could play a role. And we talked to all of our guys and said, look, these are the things that we're thinking about, and nobody's required to do anything. There's a lot of tough stuff that's out there with the tragedy that took place. And literally every single guy said, look, whatever we need to do, we're here to do it. And ultimately, literally every single player, for two straight days, we went out. We limited our practice sessions leading into our first game. And the guys just went out and did whatever we asked them. And so we took them throughout the community. No agenda, just let's go talk to people and see how we can help. And then really Derek England stepped forward and said, hey, I want to play a more visible role in the healing here. And whether it was opening night in terms of what he did on the speech on October 10th, which was spectacular, but really throughout the season. He didn't want it to just kind of go away after opening night. And so every single game, we had a Vegas strong moment to not only recognize whether it be first responders or actual people that were affected by the tragedy itself, but he made it a memorable experience for all of those people that were affected. So he bought their tickets, and then he visited with them, each and every one of them, after the game. And give him a lot of credit, because again, there was a lot of time and money that he invested in that process, but he did it because it was the right thing to do. And for him, even though he didn't grow up here, this is his home. He's been here now 13 years. His wife, Melissa, this is her home. And his kids were born here. And so, you know, I really give him a lot of credit. It wasn't comfortable for him, but he knew it was the right thing to do. And we're really proud of him to have him in our organization.
That's great. I've seen what he has done for the community. And then getting on to the economic side of it, mm-hmm. people have stickers on their car. Everybody's buying jerseys and gear. How has the Golden Knights contributed to our economic impact on the city?
Well, again, I'll kind of separate the question a little bit. The retail piece of that for us, you know, those are the team's economics, which is a positive thing, right? You know, to have people buying your merchandise at the level that they did. It was the number one jersey in all of the National Hockey League, which was incredible. Our retail per capita, so per capita spending at games during the regular season in the playoffs, by far number one in the National Hockey League. What happened in the actual Stanley Cup Finals was an NHL record. There had never been a per capita spending for retail products at that level, and so that's great. Again, it's good for the team economics. It's also good because we love to see our brand out in the marketplace and helps you know, deepen that connection. But I think the real economic impact, though, is really what was happening in other places. So as this community came together to watch games at restaurants and bars and at other people's homes, all of those economic impacts to me are more important in terms of what they mean. Those aren't necessarily our impacts directly to our bottom line. But they're impacting our community in a positive way. The number of visiting fans, as they would come in to the marketplace and come to games. So when we played Philadelphia, and those fans were a little bit obnoxious, but Toronto and St. Louis and Boston and New York, I mean, you go right on down the line, those fans could not have been more fantastic. They would come into our market, they would stay in our hotels, they would visit our restaurants, they would come out to Golden Knights games and buy our tickets. They would buy our retail products. I loved watching fans of other teams standing in line to buy our jersey, which gets back to that point I made about second favorite team component. I also think it made for a better atmosphere for games at T-Mobile. There was more energy. It felt like a playoff game every single game that we played. But those economics and those impacts and that visibility Las Vegas has always had visibility, right? This is one of the top branded cities in the world. It's probably top 10. But it gave it a perspective and a view different from what it's known for right now. When you think about the gaming and the entertainment side of Las Vegas, it gave Vegas a different narrative. And again, we're proud to be associated with that. But we'll let the economists in the market determine what the overall, and we're working on that, what the overall economic impacts are. But I can tell you that not all of it is tangible and financial. I think the bigger impact is what it did for the confidence of this community and how it helped heal the community, but also gave it a different confidence. And again, that's something we're proud to be a part of.
Lastly, how are you going to top the first season coming into the next couple months as the October 4th is the start of a season?
Yeah, home opener, Philadelphia again.
Philadelphia, yeah.
So we open up training camp the second week of September. We play our first preseason game on the 16th. I don't believe in honeymoons. You know, people ask me all the time, well, you had this great honeymoon, you had this great first season, what are you going to do? And I really believe great companies always find ways to grow and build. And it's the companies that aren't great, that are just average or good, that have a honeymoon. And so we're not interested in a honeymoon. You won't hear that come out of our organization. What we are interested in is going deeper with our brand. We're interested in going deeper with our fan base. And George McPhee and our entire hockey group is working every single day to build on what we did last year. Are we going to have 110 points? I don't know. But what I do know is we're building for the long term, and we're not going to stop until we have our ultimate goal, which is to win a Stanley Cup for Las Vegas. And so that mission and that focus is still there every single day. and all of the other aspects that contribute to the business. You're going to see more of what you've seen. My hope is that you say we saw it at another level, because that's the way we're wired as an organization. And not only are we going to do it different, but we're going to do it better.
Thank you, Carrie, for joining us today. Now sending it over to David with our panel discussion.
Welcome to this week's panel. I'm joined by my guests, the man, the myth, the legend himself, John Castanino. Always a pleasure. Casey and Jack. So this is a special Golden Knights edition of the Rebel Report. So I got some Golden Knights questions for some of the biggest Golden Knights fans in town.
I hope so. We're also journalists, okay? I'll have you know.
Well, I want you to get down and dirty with this question, John. Since we've gone to so many of these games together, we've talked to the players themselves. Who are some of the key pieces to the Stanley Cup run this past season? Who are some of the people, the guys you watched closely? Just throw some names out
there. Where do you start, right, David? I mean, seriously, where do you start? You talk about how this team, so many components. Jonathan Marchessault had another great season. William Karlsson scoring 6 times his career high in goals. I mean, David Perron had 60 assists. I mean, you look down the list, there is no one person that I can look at, or two people, or three for that matter. Pierre-Edouard Belmar, one of the stalwarts, I would make the argument that he was one of the MVPs this year. You may not see it on the stat sheet, but that fourth line played so well for the entire season from start to finish. They really were the unsung heroes, I think, for a lot of the season. But then, honestly, if I were to pick one person, no questions, Marc-Andre Fleury. The way that he closed out the end of the regular season and just played out of his mind in the playoffs, 4 shutouts, I think, in the first 6 games or whatever it was, first 6 wins. He was something else. And the cool part is that, you know, so many people thought he was done in Pittsburgh. He came to Vegas. Career year for him. He was injured for a bulk of it, right, with the concussion. But after that, put up career-high numbers. And now he's locked in for a little while. Kerry Buchholz mentioned that earlier. People of this city has fallen in love with him, really. I mean, he's such a likable guy. I think if one person, it would be Marc-Andre Fleury, but as a whole, it's just hard to point to one.
Yeah, there's a lot of great stories to come out from this past season. Marc-Andre Fleury especially, he really became like the dominating figure of this team. But how about, just to go in depth a little bit more, my guy, Malcolm Subban, didn't get any playing time, but he's such a great goalie. I mean, I would have loved to see him play. And Fleury got in. I can't put anything against Fleury in the final. They put him in, the defense put him in situations he should have never been in. So allowing 4 goals in a game, right. 3 goals, you know, it should have never happened. And it doesn't fall entirely on Fleury.
No. But they were a MASH unit when he went down, right? And again, another unsung hero, it's the 4 other goaltenders that's not playing time. I mean, there's no question. It's just so hard to pick out, you know, who were the difference makers, because you can easily argue that everybody, Brad Hunt, who didn't play at all in the playoffs, and he was one of the guys that solidified this team, high character guy. And that's what, you know, Kerry talked about in the interview, and what George McPhee brought in, these high character guys. So there's no way that you can just identify one or two and say these two are the reason for a run to the Stanley Cup final.
Now, Casey, just to sort of piggyback off the Marc-Andre Fleury talk, Fleury just signed a 3-year, $21 million contract extension. Give me your thoughts on this contract extension. What do you think this means for the Golden Knights heading into the next few years?
Well, that contract actually put him as the third highest paid goaltender in the league at this point. But as far as like team momentum, like what we just established was a brand, essentially, a name brand of this first season team. You know, if you let all your big names go, you're going to lose momentum of the fans. I mean, for that matter, like when we went to go buy a $200 jersey with Fleury's name on the back, they were sold out, right?
Yeah, and it was pretty much anything at that store was sold out.
Right.
The line was going all the way out into the sidewalk at the Arsenal.
So, yeah, you've got one of the most popular names in Vegas staying in Vegas for the next 3 years. So that's huge.
And 3 years from now, the face of this team could be completely different, but Fleury will still be there. And I think he's a guy that the Golden Knights seem committed to for the long run, and the fans seem happy. Now, Jack, going into talking about the future, that's funny. This all sort of segued into one another. When this was all sort of unexpected with the Stanley Cup run and everything. How long until they actually win the Stanley Cup?
That is a great question. Like you said,
They were really successful their first year, and I'm hoping as fans they can get to the Cup, back to the Cup in the next 2 years. But realistically, I think it might take like 8 or 9 years to actually win the Cup.
I totally agree with you. I mean, I don't want to sound like I was against the team throughout the playoff run, but realistically, please, John.
You've been doing this all season, right? You thought they were going to lose to the Sharks. You thought they were going to lose to the Jets. I'm calling you out. And then, oh, you finally were proven right when they lost to the Capitals in the Stanley Cup final. Give me a break.
Capitals were my preseason pick.
Give me a break.
For the Stanley Cup.
Give me a break.
I'm sorry that the Golden Knights had to run into that brick wall of the Capitals, but it had to
I don't know if it's going to be 8 or 9 years, like Jack says, but Vegas has to enjoy this. They have to savor it because it's not snap your fingers, make it to a Stanley Cup. But they got here in year one. They're a playoff team for sure. Can they recreate that magic in the playoffs? Sure that they can, but certainly that they have the team that's capable of doing it. So I'll give you your final word, and then we got to get out of here. Make sure it's like 30 seconds, though.
All right, I'll keep
it's
this
only
quick,
an hour
John.
Long show.
The inaugural season, nobody expected it to go down the way it did. I think that that high level of play, it's something very difficult to keep up throughout the entire course of a season going into June. If they're able to do it again next season, I mean, hey, maybe they might be a first-round playoff team. I don't want to say
they're a playoff team.
They might be a first-round playoff team.
They're a playoff team.
But, you know, they still look good for the next few years anyway. They look good for the next few years. But that's all the time we have for today. Thank you guys for joining us. It was a good discussion. Didn't mean to make it heated at all.
Thanks for leading that amazing panel, David.
Let's go back to the desk.
Before our Golden Knights made history, there was a lot of speculation if Vegas could be a hockey town. Our city proved everyone wrong. We rallied behind the team the entire way, especially during the playoffs. Vegas Golden Knights pride spread across the valley. Check it out. From Lady Liberty wearing a 600-pound jersey to the MGM Lion showing off its latest Golden Knights tattoo, from the Strip all the way to Summerlin, the Rampart Casino made sure they were showing their support. And what about this hand-painted black and gold fire hydrant? Was there something that you did to show off your VGK spirit?
I attended the games. And I cheered for the team. I don't think it gets any better than that.
No face paint?
No face paint for me. They were giving out tattoos, but I chickened out in the last second.
Sin City is known to be the entertainment capital of the world. There is also always something fun to do in Vegas. A couple of our Golden Knights hit the red carpet. We go back to Michaela Jackson, who got a chance to interview them. Michaela?
Thanks, guys. A couple of our Golden Misfits hit the Strip to see the newest headliner, Gwen Stefani. I was there for my internship. Let's take a look. Gwen Stefani's residency kicked off June 27th, and a couple of our favorite hockey players made it to the red carpet for the opening night. Defenseman Derek England and goaltender Marc-Andre Fleury, along with their wives, strolled down the red carpet. Let's see if our Golden Misfits have what it takes to sing a couple of Gwen Stefani hits.
Can I sing? I don't sing at all. No.
You attempt to sing.
No, I don't sing at all unless I'm by myself. Yeah.
Could you sing It's Bananas? You spell it out basically. It's bananas.
See, you get it. Just go like this.
They might have sang their favorite Gwen song, but Derek mentioned which show he would perform for on the Vegas Strip.
God, that's tough. The Knights is a show on the Strip, no? Hockey, yeah. Other than that, God. I'd probably want to do some Cirque du Soleil act at Strength or something along those lines. There's little talking, if any, and that kind of thing, I guess. I don't know.
The first season is over, and the Golden Knights are enjoying what Vegas has to offer. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Michaela. David, can you sing Bananas?
No, I cannot. I'm not familiar with Bananas.
B-A-N-A-N-A-N-A.
I'm sorry. B-A-N-A.
Okay. Back to hockey.
Don't know, Lupita. N-O-N-O-N-O-N-O. There you go.
Back to hockey.
Fleury and England were not the only hockey players that got to check out what Vegas has to offer. Right after the draft, the Golden Knights held development camp for their new recruits and other prospects.
I got the chance to attend one of their scrimmages and talk with some of the new players that were selected in the draft to find out what their first days in Vegas were like.
The season is over, but hockey is nonstop here in Vegas. We are currently at development camp here at City National Arena, where we're getting to see some of the new players that were selected in the draft. Straight out of the NHL draft and into the Vegas Heat, the Golden Knights showcased some of their new recruits during development camp, which was held June 26th through the 30th. For many of the players, like newly drafted Paul Cotter, the Vegas weather is quite different than what they are used to.
It's crazy. I think the heat kind of is self-explanatory a little bit. As soon as we got here, me and Brandon Cruz went out to lunch. And it was about a mile or two, but by the time we get there, I think we were about to pass out. So it's nuts. But I mean, talk about the hotel that we're in. I mean, you look outside our window and it's palm trees and pools. So yeah, you can't ask much more than that.
Along with Cotter, who played for the Lincoln Stars during the 2017-2018 season, some of the other newly drafted players who participated in the camp were Xavier Butchert, Peter DeLiberatore, and Connor Corcoran, who anchored the blue line for the Windsor Spitfires during the 2017-2018 season.
This is my first development camp, so I wanted to come in here and, you know, just take what I can in and learn from some of the guys who have been called up to Vegas or in the AHL and learn from them. And yeah, just been doing that so far, and hopefully I can take it back to my team in Windsor.
I think this one's a little different. As a first-year guy, I think my goal was to just come in and be a sponge, kind of gauge it a little bit, and it's going well. You know, the trainers here, each guy kind of has their own thing, so if you learn one thing from each guy, I think going back to Lincoln or Western, you know, I'll be set with all these different techniques of different workouts, skating tricks, stick handling, so really cool.
Hopefully we will get to see some of these faces returning in the future. For the Rebel Report, I'm Lupita Negrete.
Now those players will be heading back home, hopefully with a little more knowledge and skills than when they arrived.
Our reporter, Michaela, also attended the scrimmage and shows us just how many fans showed up to see the new recruits, just like they've shown up all season long.
Vegas can't get enough of hockey. The Golden Knights' first season may be over, but fans are still piling in to see the development camp. There were a lot of oohs and ahs from the crowd throughout the scrimmage. Mike Lawrence couldn't miss hockey for a minute, so he went to see development camp.
This is more exciting because of the game itself, whereas Golden Knights practices are more organized, one-on-one. They'll perhaps have drills, face-offs.
One of the biggest Golden Knights fans made an appearance at the development camp. It was the one and only Bark Andre Fleury. Plus, City National Arena was packed with Vegas fans to see the new recruits, and Paul Cotter noticed the atmosphere.
Yeah, I mean, I can't express it enough. We had training, just skating training at 9 in the morning, and they're all there packed in and having a Vegas chant. So, I mean, it's crazy. But, you know, it's so special for a fan base like that with our team. You know, talk about Twitter and Instagram. They're all DMing us saying, you know, welcome to the family and everything. And that means so much.
Fans are still repping their Golden Knight gear during the off season. The players were surprised this many fans came to see them play. For the Royal Report, I'm Michaela Jackson.
Again, Vegas continues to prove that we are a hockey town. Fans came out to watch the prospects who are not even on the roster yet. The Golden Knights received a lot of coverage last season, but it's the people behind the scenes who are responsible for how the team is represented in the media. I spoke to Director of Communications, Sage Sammons, and he's also a UNLV alum, just to get a little insight on what he does for the team.
Of the Golden Knights, you probably think of their inaugural season, their historic run to the Stanley Cup Final, and the madness that ensued at T-Mobile Arena every game night. But you probably don't think of what's going on behind the scenes, and the people responsible for getting media coverage on the team. UNLV grad Sage Sammons is the director of communications for the Knights, and a big part of getting the appropriate media coverage for the team.
You see, our press boxes is completely full, and then we have to make a secondary media area that overlooks the ice on the south end of T-Mobile Arena, which was standing room only for guests at T-Mobile, is now a completely different media area. So it's unreal. It's fun to be part of, you know, and especially in year one, nobody really thought that this is where we'd end up, but it's really exciting to be part of the journey.
Having worked for UNLV's athletic department before graduating to the NHL, and despite an exciting inaugural season for the Knights, Sammons is still a rebel at heart.
So my last year in school, I took an internship with the athletic department and gave up my paid, wasn't even that well paid, but my paid gig as being the sports editor of the school paper for an unpaid internship with the athletic department, and loved it. Absolutely put in a lot of time. Anytime I wasn't in class, I was there doing my internship, and then ended up spending 5 great years at UNLV professionally. Loved every second of it. It was really, really enjoyable. Didn't really have any interest to leave. I had a couple opportunities to go to, you know, quote unquote, bigger schools in different cities around the country, but ended up wanting to stay in Las Vegas, and this was the one opportunity I was really, really looking at.
Even though it's the off-season for the Golden Knights, Sammons is still hard at work, with development camp ending in late June and training camp coming up in September. The Golden Knights will begin their next season on October 4th against the Flyers. For the Rebel Report, I'm David Stepanian.
Sammons is enjoying his work for the Golden Knights and doesn't plan to go anywhere else anytime soon. Now, this was the Golden Knights' first ever season, and not only did they make it to the Stanley Cup Final, but they reunited a city.
And they showed us how to do the impossible and make history. So we and many other fans wanted to thank the Golden Knights for what they have done.
I would just say thank you for everything that they've done as far as off the ice, more so than on the ice, but also I appreciate all the hard work and dedication they put in. You can tell that they were a team that really kind of left it out there every single time they touched the ice, but then not only that, you know, they took the time out to visit people and also, you know, sign autographs after every practice and really get out in the community, and sometimes you don't see that as much with professional teams, but these guys truly care about the community, and I think I'm proud of that.
Hey VGK, thank you for a great inaugural season. I'm so excited for next season to start. Thank you so much for getting us all the way to the playoffs and even to the final round. And yeah, go Knights go!
Hi, I just wanted to give a big thank you to the Vegas Golden Knights for uniting our city in so many ways and showing us just how fun hockey can be.
Thank you so much, Golden Knights, for everything you have done. Not only did you heal our city, but you brought us closer. And we have something to rally around. And I just can't believe how far you guys come this season. And it just warms my heart every time I see you on the TV. So thank you. Thank you for making it as far as you did. And if we don't make it that far next season, I'm gonna have a blast as well. Thanks, guys.
Well, I would say thank you for bringing Major League sports to this town and making it the very best it could possibly be.
Thanks, guys, for a great season. We had a blast with you, and having our fans start to be lifelong fans, our kids being lifelong fans, it's been great. Thanks so much.
Well, I definitely want to give a huge thank you to the Golden Knights as a fan. Can't say enough about having something that Las Vegas can finally call its own. I grew up here. I'm from here originally. We never had that until the Knights came along and we saw how this community really rallied around this team through good times and not so good times. When you talk about 1 October, and as a journalist, we were able to cover all the games we wanted, even the Stanley Cup. So we're thrilled about what they were able to do, and we're looking forward to year two and beyond.
So my thank you video was truly something epic. I had Bill Foley in there, William Carlson, Marc-Andre Fleury. They're all in there just saying thank you, but due to technical malfunctions, any evidence this video ever existed is gone. So this was my way of saying thank you. Those guys aren't here, but thank you, Golden Knights, for an awesome season.
Well, that wraps up our Vegas Golden Knights special edition show. We would like to thank the Golden Knights organization for letting us cover the games, and a special thank you to John Castanino for letting us join him at the games and making us a part of their history.
Next season on the Rebel Report, we will continue our coverage on the Golden Knights. Season 2. See you then.
Whatever it takes.